We want to thank Google's Science Journal app for supporting PBS Digital Studios. It's the one part of us that we think of as being synonymous with life. If it stops working, we die. It's also the only part of us that we say we can give to someone else. And if they break it, it's the worst feeling in the world. You can't talk about either love or life without talking about the heart. And the story of the organ that's pumping in your chest right now is an epic saga that goes far back in deep time. In fact, it goes back at least 520 million years when an underwater landslide in ancient China buried a tiny arthropod called Fuxianhuia potenza. Fuxianhuia was small, no bigger than one of the credit cards in your wallet, with a segmented body, an impressive pair of mandibles, and eyes on the ends of two stalks. It had the tools of a swift ocean predator, which means it probably needed a lot of oxygen. And this may explain why Fuxianhuia is the earliest animal known to have a blood circulatory system, as well as an organ to keep its blood moving. The first known traces of a very early heart. Now, the path that connects this ancient predator to you isn't a short, straight line. It's long, with lots of sidetracks that lead to other, more familiar organisms that also have hearts. It includes animals like slugs and snails, and insects and crustaceans, and the first vertebrates to walk on four legs. It took hundreds of millions of years and countless different iterations of the same basic structure to lead to the heart that you have today. So yes, you're right to think that your heart is important and worth protecting, because the story of its origin is an ancient one, as old as animal life itself. In order to understand where hearts came from, we have to go back to the earliest common ancestor of everything that has a heart. Now, we don't have a fossil of that ancestor, but we do have some proof of its existence, its genes. We, and everything else that has a heart, carry some of the same genes that this organism had. Those genes are responsible for developing blood vessels that can contract to push blood around. And over time, an incredibly diverse group of animals has used this basic set of instructions to arrive at different solutions for circulating blood. We can tease apart the history of the heart by studying the genomes of living organisms that share these heart-making genes. And using the method known as the molecular clock, which combines what we know about genetic mutation rates with insights from well-dated fossils, it seems that the common ancestor of all animals with a heart lived way back in the Neoproterozoic era, between 600 million and 700 million years ago. But oddly enough, even though it gave rise to all the organisms that have hearts, this ancestor probably didn't have a heart of its own. So, the genes that are used to form hearts today are actually older than the heart itself. Instead of a heart, researchers believe that this ancestor used blood vessels to push blood through its body. This type of system is called a peristaltic pump, and it works kind of like your intestines do, with muscles gradually squeezing to move material along. Annelid worms and the marine chordates known as lancelets have both held on to this simple model of blood circulation. So scientists think that this is probably what our ancestor had, the simplest version of a system that's shared by all of its descendants. Now, over evolutionary time, practically every animal that's descended from this ancestor has added complexity to this basic system. And they did so independently, as natural selection acted time and again on that peristaltic pump and the genes that make it possible. The circulatory systems in these animals often became more complex because they tended toward more active lifestyles. I mean, if you're a worm, a peristaltic pump works just fine. But for active predators and animals that need to move quickly, that just wasn't effective enough. To supply a more complex and more active body with more oxygen, the solution for most animals was a heart. Now, not all animals today have what we'd call a true heart, but some version of an organ for circulating blood has evolved in at least three major groups: the arthropods, the mollusks, and us vertebrates. The arthropod version of a heart is really a long tube-like structure that runs the length of the animal's body, called a dorsal vessel. Its job is to collect blood and propel it in one direction, toward the head. It doesn't look much like a heart, and not all researchers are willing to call it one, but it performs a comparable function. And that dorsal vessel has been around for a long time. We know that because we've seen it in those fossils of Fuxianhuia. In 2014, researchers studied a specimen that was so well preserved that they could actually make out the traces of its dorsal vessel. And the scientists were able to reconstruct it based on its similarities with the hearts of modern arthropods. So we know Fuxianhuia had this dorsal vessel, but it's not clear when this structure first evolved in arthropods, or if it evolved more than once. There's still a healthy debate among researchers about when exactly different lineages gained or lost their blood-pumping organs. Because different kinds of arthropods have dorsal vessels that are really different from each other, and some don't have any at all. So this makes it hard to say if these vessels are a single ancestral feature, or something that showed up on its own convergently many times. Still, we do know that the earliest arthropods go back not long before Fuxianhuia, to about 542 million years ago, at the very end of the Ediacaran period. So it's safe to assume that their version of a not-quite heart is at least that old. And this same reasoning applies to mollusks. This group includes gastropods, like snails and slugs, cephalopods, like squid and octopodes, and bivalves, like clams and mussels, among many others. All of these animals have hearts, so it's likely that their common ancestor had a heart too. And the ancestor of all mollusks goes even further back in the Ediacaran period, to a fossil of a squishy little seafloor dweller known as Kimberella. This animal is sometimes interpreted as a mollusk. And if it is one, then the common ancestor of mollusks and its ancestral heart has to be at least as old as it and the other earliest fossil mollusks. And that's at least 550 million years old. Now, unlike arthropods, mollusks have hearts with multiple chambers. Generally, one or more of the chambers collects oxygenated blood from the gills. These are called auricles. Then they feed the oxygen-rich blood into another chamber called a ventricle, which pumps the blood out to the rest of the body. And the more complex the mollusk, the more complex its heart is. For example, in addition to a central chambered heart, most cephalopods like cuttlefish, octopodes, and squid have two extra branchial hearts that pump blood to their gills. Now, three hearts might seem like a lot, but they may have played a key role in helping some cephalopods develop a more active lifestyle. Now it's our time. We vertebrates have also evolved more complex hearts, but we followed a different path than the mollusks. Molecular clock studies suggest that some of the genes responsible for creating heart muscle were evolving in vertebrates and our closest relatives from about 540 million to 570 million years ago. Meanwhile, the genes that create the specialized tissue that lines our blood vessels, known as endothelium, date back between 510 million to 540 million years ago. So it seems likely that by the end of the Ediacaran period, the vertebrate circulatory system was also well on its way. The earliest fossil we have of a vertebrate heart belongs to a fish called Rachalepus, and it has two chambers, as all fish hearts do. But Rachalepus lived only about 115 million years ago, so while it's the earliest physical evidence we have, it's way too recent to tell us much about the early evolutionary path that our hearts have taken. The hearts of our earliest vertebrate ancestors were probably similar to that found in Rachalepus, in that they likely had two chambers, an atrium to collect blood and a ventricle to push it back out to the body. And we think that because that's how the hearts of vertebrates, including yours, start out during embryonic development. All vertebrate hearts develop according to a common pattern. In the embryo, a blood vessel twists in on itself to create two chambers, and then it develops depending on what kind of organism it is and what other genetic instructions it has. But the fact that every vertebrate develops a heart in the same way suggests that a two-chambered plan is shared among us all. And again, vertebrate hearts became more sophisticated as the animals themselves became more complex and more active. Amphibians, for example, first appear in the fossil record around 360 million years ago. And today, most of them have two atria, one for collecting oxygenated blood and one for collecting deoxygenated blood, as well as a single ventricle. But some of the more basal or primitive living amphibians have chambers that aren't totally separated, sort of like they have two and a half chambers. So their common ancestor probably didn't have three well-defined chambers either, and instead, that came later. Mammals, meanwhile, have four chambers, and although a shared mammalian ancestor appeared somewhere around 200 million years ago, it's not totally clear when we acquired our four-chambered heart. In the mammalian heart, the right atrium and ventricle collect deoxygenated blood and send it to the lungs, and the left atrium and ventricle collect oxygenated blood from the lungs and send it out to the body. So, arthropods, mollusks, and vertebrates all separately acquired some version of a heart within the same general stretch of geologic time, in the late Ediacaran period and early Cambrian. But even though all these hearts look quite different, they're all just variations on a theme, derived from the same basic set of genetic instructions that dates back to that common ancestor that lived more than 600 million years ago. And believe it or not, we can even track the evolution of those individual ancient genes that make our hearts possible. In 1993, a researcher in Michigan found that the dorsal vessel in fruit flies develops with the help of a gene known as Tin Man. You know, like from The Wizard of Oz? Because without a Tin Man gene, the flies don't have a heart? This gene instructs developing tissues to differentiate into various kinds of cardiac cells. And later studies found that we vertebrates have our own equivalent of the Tin Man gene. And it turns out that our gene is similar enough to Tin Man that researchers believe they both evolved from a single earlier gene that was present in that common ancestor that lived more than 600 million years ago. In humans, this gene is given the less catchy name of NKX25. And just like in fruit flies, it instructs the developing tissue that it's expressed in to generate the many different kinds of cells that make a heart. So even though the dorsal vessel of a fly and the heart that's beating in your chest right now don't seem to have a lot in common, we have our 600 million year old ancestor to thank for the genes that make both of them. Over vast stretches of geologic time, natural selection has acted on this genetic legacy over and over as animals became more complex. The result is the variety of systems that we find today, in fruit flies, and cuttlefish, and you, as well as in Fushianwiya, a humble arthropod from the distant past. Like every other part of you, your heart is as complex as the story behind it. So the next time you give your heart away to someone, be sure that they know that your gift is more than a half billion years in the making. Thanks to Google for supporting PBS Digital Studios. Their mobile app, Science Journal, lets you take notes and measure scientific phenomena such as light, sound, and motion using your phone, tablet, or Chromebook. You can find activity ideas and additional information on their website at g.co/sciencejournal or check out the link in the description below. An extra big thanks to our current eontologists, Jake Hart, John Ivey, John Davison Ng, and Steve. If you'd like to join them and our other patrons in supporting what we do here, then go to patreon.com/eons and make your pledge. Now, what do you want to learn about? Leave us a comment and don't forget to go to youtube.com/eons and subscribe.